esteemed ministers, commissioner, dear participants. Well over 2 years ago, I wrote to Prime Minister Jyrki Katainen and proved that the Finnish government proposed that the Finnish government would support our idea of organizing in June 2014 a high-profile Baltic Sea Days in Turku. We expressed the hope that the concluding event of the Finnish presidency of Council of Baltic Sea States could coincide with other key conferences such as the Baltic Development Forum Summit and the annual forum of the European Union strategy for the Baltic Sea region. Very soon we got a positive response from the Finnish government, and not long after that the European Commission and BDF similarly decided to organize their key events to Turku. On behalf of the city, I'm very grateful to the Finnish government, the European Commission and the Baltic Development Forum for the trust you have shown towards Turku. We see this as a vote of confidence and a recognition for the long-standing work carried out in Turku in Baltic Sea issues. Thank you also for the excellent cooperation during all stages of preparations. To organize events like these is always a very big challenge. However, the international situation has added its own sour spices to these preparations and has influenced the course of development. Thus, it proved not to be possible to organize the Prime Minister's meeting in Turku for reasons we are well aware of. With this in mind, I'm extremely pleased to note that your response to the invitation to Turku has been so overwhelming. We have to offer a high-class, interesting program for you, well over 1,000 registered participants. Thank you, organizers, speakers, and participants alike. Dear friends, the birth, history, and development of Turku have been closely connected to the integration in the Baltic Sea region. Centrally located at the crossroads of the Baltic Sea, Turku has since the Hanseatic times served as Finland's gateway to the Europe and to the world. Turku is the oldest city of Finland, and we are proud of our history. However, our eyes are firmly focused forward. There is no contradiction between yesterday and tomorrow. Strong culture always combines something old and something new. A concrete example is seen around us here in Logomo. As part of our year as the European Capital of Culture in 2011, this old rough locomotive engineering building has been reborn as a great events and conference hall as a home of creative companies. Locomo symbolizes our wider look at the city development, building on the past, heading for the future. Today, Turku is known for its top-class universities, vibrant businesses, and thriving cultural life. It is the growth center of Southwest Finland, next to what many consider to be the most beautiful archipelago in the world. The theme of this combined BDF summit and annual forum of the EU Baltic Sea strategy is growing together for a prosperous, inclusive and connected Baltic Sea region. Thus, we want to emphasize the importance of sustainable growth here in the top of Europe, essential to achieve our common goals and to fulfill the needs and expectations of our citizens. The Baltic Sea region has a great potential to be a leading region, not only in Europe, but worldwide. By removing obstacles from cooperation and pooling our efforts together, can this be done? This cooperation has to be inclusive to involve all countries of the region. The Baltic Sea cannot be saved. Logistical connections built, youth and university exchange developed, criminal plans counted without close cooperation. Only by working together, guided by common interest and based on agreed principles, can we mobilize the full potential of the Baltic Sea region. The city of Turku, through the Turku process, has been assigned the task to serve as a horizontal action leader of the European Union strategy for the Baltic Sea region. In this role, which we take seriously, we will continue to do our best to ensure that the Russian, Belarusian, Norwegian and Icelandic partners will increasingly join in common action. While the international situation may negatively influence official relations between Russia and EU at the top level, contacts between stakeholders on the regional level may actually get an added importance. We are ready to take the new initiatives to promote practical, mutually beneficial cooperation. During the preparation of this conference and the whole Turku-Baltic Sea Week, our city has emphasized especially three issues. The first is the growth zone from Stockholm to St. Petersburg. The second is blue growth, and the third is bio and health. This northern growth zone is ambitious long-term concept to bring together dynamic partners in the northern shores of the Baltic Sea to boost regional attractiveness and competitiveness. The growth zone forms a part of larger entity, a European-wide market and transport network stretching across southern Finland. It makes up to the northernmost 10T core network corridor between EU and Russia. For us, key elements in this are the one-hour train from Turku to Helsinki and the motorway of the seas from Turku to Stockholm. Beyond logistic, the growth zone is also a future-oriented platform to bring together multi-level stakeholders into true public-private partnership to promote smart development. The Turku region is also a leading production cluster for the Finnish maritime industry and a center for maritime know-how and innovations. Blue Growth, employing some 8,000 persons across 400 businesses, brings together a broad group of maritime industry stakeholders. The biggest and most luxurious cruise vessels in the world have been constructed here. Shipbuilding will increasingly be complemented by new offshore and Arctic maritime industry activities. The European Maritime Day conference in May 2016 in Turku will be an excellent platform to present and develop these innovations. Life sciences have long history in Turku region. BioTurku is Finland's leading biotechnology center based at Turku Science Park. It combines training, research, production development, manufacturing, and commercialization under a single umbrella. Aurea Biobank is the first clinical biobank in Finland and will play a key role in the clinical research as sample stored in the, it can be used for clinical research purpose and developed of target diagnostic methodologies. Friends and colleagues, Turku has had and continues to have a long-term commitment for Baltic Sea cooperation. Centrum Balticum Foundation, Finland's think tank on Baltic Sea issues, is our ambitious platform to promote regional cooperation nationally and internationally. We very much welcome the agreement signed yesterday between Centrum Balticum and the Finnish Ministry for Foreign Affairs about supporting the ministry in sparing national information about the EU strategy for the Baltic Sea region and mobilizing national stakeholders to participate in this implementation. Before closing, I would like to inform you about a new initiative to promote regional cooperation. Baleks, Baltic Area Legal Studies, is a joint initiative of Åbo Academy University and the University of Turku to establish a juridical competence center specializing on the Baltic Sea region and to fill the vacuum in juridical research and education. We are confident that Baleks will be an important element in our joint effort to turn regional opportunities into deepened cooperation and practical results. Dear participants, dear friends, once more, I want to welcome you most warmly to Turku. I do hope that in addition to the interesting conference sessions, you will have opportunity to know better our city and its life. The banks of our river can serve as a good starting point for your explorations. Enjoy your stay in Turku and once more welcome.
Thank you, Mayor Randell. I'd like to introduce ourselves, the moderators for today, to guide you through today and tomorrow. My name is Emily Wise. I'm a researcher at Lund University and a public policy consultant in Sweden and around the Baltic Sea region. And I've been at Baltic Development Forum Summit since 2003, but this is my first time to be able to guide you folks through the day. And I'm together here with a more seasoned veteran.
Thank you very much, Emily. Seasoned veteran sounds pretty good. Still alive. Pavel Schweboda, I'm president of Demos Europa Center for European Strategy, an institute based in Warsaw. And I'm delighted to be able to moderate our 2 days of proceedings together with Emily. We have a very rich program. We will be with you until the dusk tomorrow, so you'll get used to us whether you want it or not. And once more, very warm welcome to the 16th Summit of the Baltic Development Forum and the 5th Annual Forum of the EU Strategy for the Baltic Sea Region. Being a veteran, I remember vividly last year's discussion in Riga, which was focused very much on what the crisis has meant to the region. But my feeling, to be totally honest with you, was that we are doing just so much better than the rest of Europe. Our discussion was focused on building high-speed train links, on building bridges, rather than on how to handle the worst of the crisis. And with today's goal of discussing a prosperous, inclusive, and connected region, I think we are raising that bar of ambition even higher. But to guide us through these themes, we have three seasoned politicians to give introductory remarks. Jan Vapaavuori, a Finnish Minister for Economic Affairs, Johannes Hahn, Commissioner for Regional Policy, and Lene Espersen, Chairman of the Baltic Development Forum. Please give them a very warm welcome to this summit. And without further ado, Minister Vapaavuori, could you tell us how do we get from here to being a prosperous, inclusive and connected region? The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Commissioner, Chairman Espersen, Mr. Mayor. I don't know whether I have an answer to your question, but anyhow, I have some opening remarks. As a start, I, however, would like to also, on behalf of the Finnish government, wish you most welcome here to Finland and to Turku, and wish you a very good morning. Actually, Turku is a great city to host the 16th Baltic Development Forum and the 5th Annual Forum of the European Union's Strategy for the Baltic Sea Region. Turku is a great example how to create successful business in various sectors in Baltic Sea region and how to respect clean nature in the Baltic Sea nation. This meeting will certainly improve the awareness of Baltic issues. My team today, the Baltic Economic Cooperation, is of course not a new one. To the contrary, for almost a millennium, Baltic Sea has been a platform for economic cooperation. The Hanseatic League, or Hansa, which was established in 1356, was an early form of commercial and political cooperation in the Baltic Sea region. What is common for cooperation then and now is its informal and institution-free character. When the business interests are strong, commonly understood, and widely shared, there seems to be less need for formal structures. We could say that Baltic Sea region is an example of the benefits of trade, not only in an economic sense, but also as a stabilizing factor in the region. The Nordic countries have traditionally played a very important role in Baltic Sea region's cooperation. The Nordic countries have a long common history, which is still present in the many forms of cooperation. On the parliamentary level with Nordic Council and between governments in the Nordic Council of Ministers. The Nordic countries may have different approaches towards the membership of the European Union or European monetary policy, but the forms of regional needs-based cooperation are neutral in relation to such policy choices. The Baltic Sea region is the home for over 60 million people. The Baltic Sea region comprises a highly competitive part of the European and even of the global economy, providing a vital economic environment to its people and enterprises. The countries around the Baltic Sea have deep historical boundaries and economic ties integrating the people and business together. The region's economic size is also impressive. According to the most recent State of Region report, the annual GDP is more than 1,300 billion euros. Northern Germany and northwestern Russia account both for roughly 15%, the Baltic countries 7%, and the northern Poland 5%. The Nordic countries account for the most, that is 60% of the total. The Baltic Sea region went along with the European slowdown, even if it remained at a higher level of economic dynamism than its European peers. However, there are some risks in the expected recovery and growth in the Baltic Sea states, currently not the least due to the situation in Ukraine. This may hamper the economic activity across the Baltic Sea region. Most exports from the Baltic Sea region continue to be destined for markets nearby, emphasizing the benefits of mutual connections between the countries involved. Challenged by increased global competition and affected by the economic slowdown in Europe, the Baltic Sea region has in recent years lost some of its market share. The Baltic Sea region is also a home to a significant manufacturing sector. This drives exports in many products from metal manufacturing industries, the automotive industry, and production technology. The region also has a significant position in biopharmaceuticals and communication technologies, often associated with high levels of R&D, as well as in forest products and some food processing sectors. Not surprisingly, given the geographic nature of the region, transport and logistics play also a significant role in the area. It is worth emphasizing, and this may be surprising, that the Baltic Sea region continues to do better on services, where export values have been slightly growing. The Baltic Sea region is more oriented towards service exports than both the EU 28 and the world economy in all. But even for the Baltic Sea region, goods trade continues to be about three times as large in terms of overall value. Although we are living and operating in a globalized world, regional dimension is a dominant player in our lives and for the business as well. There are still multiple advantages for businesses to be connected within the regional value chains. We could call it Baltic value chains in this context. With the current phase of globalization, not only the costs, but also the risks of global value chains are increasing. Globalization has been driven by the internet and decreasing logistical costs. In regional operations, the logistics will take less resources as well as less emissions than when carried out globally. Furthermore, with the help of digitalization and the internet, the methods of production are changing in ways that reduce the relative importance of cheap manual labor and emphasizes the regional dimension of the economy. By deeper regional integration and the economic, cultural, legal, and political strengths of the Baltic Sea region have become more appreciated. Since the accession of the three Baltic states, Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, and Poland to the European Union in 2004, the Baltic Sea region has become an important strategic part of the EU. This is reflected in the European Union's strategy for the Baltic Sea region. The three main objectives of the strategy are save the sea, connect the region, and increase prosperity. Baltic Sea Strategy Action Plan includes several important aspects: environmental protection, maritime safety, economy, transport, energy, and internal security, among others. All these sectors involve much cooperation within the European Union, and they are regulated by actions and programs at EU level. However, in implementing the Baltic region strategies, we need to identify such joint actions and projects that bring added value, particularly to the region. This is especially important now when the new program period of the structure and investments funds of the EU is about to start. The resources provided by these funds are not small. Together, we must find the best ideas how to use these resources for the common good of the Baltic Sea region. One of the main sectors in the Baltic Sea region is energy. According to the Baltic Sea Strategy's action plan, the development and integration of energy markets are the key goal. This aims to several objectives like security of energy supply, diversification of energy sources, contribution to economic growth by improving the competitiveness of the region, and encourage investments in renewable energy and overall reduction of greenhouse gas emissions through more efficient energy distribution. Also, attention must be paid to the resilience of infrastructure to natural and man-made disasters. After all, the Baltic Sea is a very shallow sea and highly vulnerable to discharges of pollution. In addition to energy sector, I would like to highlight the importance of the maritime sector for Finland and for the Baltic Sea region as a whole. Due to global competition, marine technology and shipping industries have faced some serious setbacks in the Baltic Sea region. The products and services of the Baltic Sea region companies vary, but the challenges are similar in many cases. It is inevitable that in order to develop the competitiveness of the industry, input to long-term research and development is needed, as well as smart choices made and specialization to support the high-level product and services. Strong alliances between the actors in all levels are to be sought, and new business areas and markets need to be found. Even in the Baltic Sea area, we must not underestimate the potential of the Arctic region. Finland has actually more than 60% of all icebreakers in the world. The newest icebreaker of Finland will be delivered by 2016, and it will be the first of its kind in the world to be equipped with LNG, dual fuel engine, and oil spill response equipment. Finland will not forget environmental friendliness even during harsh winters. In the Baltic Sea region, it is vital to find more and more environmental friendly solutions. Of course, the challenge of climate change is global, but in the Baltic Sea area, we can lead the way in finding sustainable solutions to this challenge. The Finnish government actually gave this May a resolution on clean tech and bioeconomy strategy. The new resolution is a clear indication of our conviction that environmental values on the one hand and economy or new business opportunities on the other are not opposites. In fact, there is no standard definition of clean technology. In general, clean tech means technologies that support increased productivity or profitability while also reducing resource consumption or pollution. This technology is vital for solving important challenges like that of the climate change. The other parts of the state government resolution concerns bioeconomy, which refers to economic activities which use renewable energy sources in natural resources in a sustainable manner for the production of bio-based products, nutrition, energy, and services. It is expected to be the next economic wave after the fossil economy. We would even like to see Finland as a clean tech and bioeconomy forerunner, a task so vast and all-encompassing that we certainly need broad cooperation with our Baltic Sea neighbors. Dear audience, ladies and gentlemen, the Baltic Sea region will remain a vibrant area also from an economic perspective. The cooperation has always been based on sound economic interests and a common will to prosper. In this spirit, we must continue to look for positive challenges that create unity, not division, in the Baltic Sea region. Environmentally adaptive economy is a common challenge for the Baltic Sea countries. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Vapaavuori, for tracing not only the historical ties, but also the current economic ties and the possibilities of reaching, addressing new opportunities, in particular energy and sustainable environmental solutions, and creating these new, introducing the concept of Baltic Sea region value chains. Very interesting. Thank you very much. Now to Commissioner Hahn, a former federal minister in Austria of Education and Research, currently the Commissioner of Regional Policy at the European Commission. We welcome you to the stage and we'd like to hear your view on the Baltic Sea region.
Yeah, good morning to everybody, Minister, Mayor, Chairman Espersen, ladies and gentlemen. Here we are again, as the years go by and I feel too well, I'm among friends at this regular gatherings of ours year by year, and I think it's indeed already a very pleasant moment to come together once a year to reflect on the progress being made or also about some shortcomings we have to face. In general, one could say it's an important year, probably every year we are saying this, but I think this year it's more than ever justified to call it a special year, because it's 25 years since the division of Europe ended, and it's 10 years since many of your countries joined the European Union. These were historic steps that changed the face of our continent and opened up new opportunities for us all, individually, regionally, and nationally. And the Baltic Sea strategy is just old enough to celebrate its own milestone anniversary, 5 years old already. 5 years developing the most ambitious strategy for cooperation in the region. I believe that in time, the development of this new macro region may prove to be as important as those earlier breakthroughs in 1989 and 2004. And it's certainly a further step to better chances for all of us, for a European integration and, of course, for closer relationship between neighbors in order to get the best results for every citizen. This is a process that has brought the Baltic states firmly back into the European family and continues to help reinforce ties to others like Norway and Iceland, who share with us the same values and mostly the same interests. Our strong preference would be to develop this region in harmonious cooperation also with the Russian Federation. We remain committed to this goal, even in very tough times. But respect for international law, respect for other sovereignty are not matters on which we can compromise. The strategy is already reaping results. Not enough people know it. Go out from this conference and make sure the people you know about the results we are achieving. Tell them about the important cooperation on addressing the dangers from chemical munition left in the Baltic Sea. This is an example of how the strategy provides help to national authorities to tackle serious risks in the region. Tell them about the phasing out of phosphates in detergents, ensuring a healthier sea for wildlife and your families. Tell them about the headway being made on e-navigation, making the Baltic Sea region a first mover in the development of infrastructure and services in this important field. Finally, tell them about the potential of biogas waiting to be exploited as a sustainable energy source for the region. But we can and must do much more. 2014 is an important year for one more reason. It's the year in which we are programming the European funds effectively for the next decade. It's a process that will have a major impact on the success of our Baltic cooperation. My services are currently hard at work screening partnership agreements and operational programs to ensure that programs for the coming period take the macro regional strategies into account. Not everything is perfect, but doors are opening to provide the financial muscle needed to make real results on the ground. Take our hosts, Finland. In the preparation of the new programming period, the Finnish authorities have emphasized Baltic Sea cooperation in a number of sectors. We really appreciate the contribution Finland makes to this strategy. And let me say, the excellent welcome to us all here in Turku. Thanks again, Mayor, for being not only the host, but together with your team, you have organized, and also with all the Finnish friends, excellent conference, and I'm sure we can really enjoy this conference and the opportunity to be here in Turku. But coming back to our programs, the aim of these programs should be to put the substantial resources available in the region to work to achieve a more prosperous and connected region with an improved environmental status of the Baltic Sea. Results that everyone in the region can see and feel. But how we are going to get the best from these investments? As you know, just days ago, the European Commission published its report on governance of macro-regional strategy. Sounds very dry, doesn't it? What this report is really about is how to make this and the other macro-regional strategies real winners. We will be discussing governance in more depth tomorrow, but the nub of it is who is responsible for doing what. The Baltic region has been the pioneer of macro-regional approach. Others are looking to you as a model and trying to copy you. We will publish a strategy for the Adriatic Ionian region in a couple of weeks and for the Alps next year, both drawing on your experience. But you have to keep on blazing the trail. Cooperation in the framework of macro-regional strategies is a long-term effort. We need you to show others how it is done. We need you to continue to explore how to maximize your cooperation to achieve results. Recent events have reminded us how important energy cooperation is. I will say more about that tomorrow. And coordination of transport policies is key to facilitating growth in the region. We need now, more than ever, to make progress in realizing the European transport corridors, to boost trade and help Europe put the crisis finally behind us. More than 1,000 people have been registered for this event here in Turku, quite a crowd. I would like to thank the city of Turku once again for this initiative, also the Baltic Development Forum and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs Finland for hosting and co-organizing this conference. Because it's so important to have this opportunity of coming together and to use it also as a kind of networking to further strengthen existing relationships, friendships, but also to create new ones. We can only be successfully if we have this personal relationship, okay? Everybody of us is able to Skype, and it's quite nice to have video conferences, but it cannot offset the personal relationship, and this is also what such a conference offers to all of us, the opportunity to come together, to share experiences in a good and maybe a better way, but in principle, it's something which offers us a lot of opportunities to make progress, to have a better outcome of our work in the future, in the interest of our European citizens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Commissioner, not only for speaking to us about the financial muscle for projects in the region, which is something that we always welcome from a Commissioner for Regional Policy, especially a national of the Danube region, warm welcome for in that context as well. But I was grateful in particular for you mentioning the year of anniversaries, because not only have we celebrated the 10th anniversary of historic EU enlargement, but as we speak, President Obama is landing in Warsaw together with 30 European leaders, including some royals, maybe one less as of yesterday, but still quite a few, to celebrate the 25th anniversary of freedom in this region. And these two events, EU enlargement and freedom, the regaining of freedom, have changed the Baltic Sea region beyond recognition. But nothing is cast in stone. We need to take care of the region as we speak. And this organic work you mentioned is necessary. The wider geopolitical issues are also important. And we need to draw attention to how the situation has changed during the course of this year. The Baltic Development Forum has been guiding us through these 25 years. And I would now like to welcome and invite to the podium Lene Espersen, who is a very familiar face in Danish and European politics, having served as Deputy Prime Minister of Denmark and Minister for the Economy, for Justice and Foreign Affairs. You've got all the wisdom. Lene, the floor is yours.
Mayor Randell, Minister Vapaavuori, Commissioner Hahn, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, and dear friends, we got a lot of friends yesterday at the reception with disco music and dancing. It was a great start of this summit. Let me first of all express my sincere appreciation to our hosts, the City of Turku and the Finnish Presidency of the Council of the Baltic Sea States, for their warm hospitality. I congratulate the City of Turku for your impressive program for the Turku Baltic Sea Days 2014. I would also like to express my sincere thanks to the Commission for co-organizing the summit with BDF for the third time. As Danish Foreign Minister and Deputy Prime Minister, I had the pleasure of taking part in the BDF and CBSS summit in Vilnius in 2010. Today, I'm here as the new chairman of the Baltic Development Forum, and I'm delighted to become more involved in the networks of the Baltic Sea region. For more than 15 years, BDF has played a role as the honest broker, agenda setter, and think tank for regional cooperation in the Baltic Sea region. And I look forward to continuing the cooperation with our many partners and friends in the coming years. I hope to have the chance to talk personally to many of you over the next 2 days. The 2014 BDF Summit is taking place at a crucial point in time. The results of the recent elections for the European Parliament has shown the dissatisfaction of many European voters. The negative economic growth and 26 million unemployed in the EU is a reflection of the economic crisis. In my opinion, the result should only encourage countries, cities, and regions to come together and to work even harder to create jobs and growth for people and companies in Europe. Our meeting will provide a valuable platform for discussions on how to strengthen our competitiveness through regional integration, cooperation, and cross-border action. Also, the recent conflict with Russia over Ukraine is giving rise to new uncertainty, politically and economically, in Europe. During the next few days, we will have the opportunity for businesses and policymakers to discuss the possible implications of the conflict. Ukraine is our neighbor, and we should think about how we could extend our strong networks and inspire Ukraine to establish a stronger civil society, the basis of any democracy and national state. I'm pleased that the NGO network of our region is also present in Turku. This is clearly a role to play for you as well as for the rest of us. It is my vision to see the Baltic Sea region to see that develop into one of the most competitive, innovative, and dynamic regions in the EU and in the world. It is ambitious, but I think it is within reach. One thing I would like to see is that we stay ambitious about our targets and outcome of our regional cooperation. Small and open economies have to stay on their toes to perform well in the international cooperation. And if we join our forces, I'm sure that we can live up to our slogan, Top of Europe. The region performed relatively well compared to others during the recent economic crisis. Not least, the Baltic states demonstrated an incredible resolve to reform the economy, cut back on public spending as a way of getting out of the crisis. The region is now doing better in terms of growth, trade, and foreign direct investments. We continue to be a highly competitive region in Europe and globally. But in the face of growing international competition and new powerful emerging regions, the key economic figures for the region are not that encouraging. Growth is positive, but growth is low. Foreign trade is increasing, but growing slowly, and we are losing market shares globally. In other words, while we are generally well positioned in trade, innovation, and investments, we are also challenged as a region. We need to do better. And in a minute, Christian Ketels will tell us more than when he represents the 2014 State of the Region report. We need to grow together, as the theme of our conference underlies, and to be stronger to uphold our already strong positions. But we also need to do it in a smart and clever way, where we set up the right priorities. It is easy to say, but more difficult to define the right priorities. I would like to give my vision of how we stay the most competitive region in the world. In my mind, that includes three things. We need to be a smart region with smart cities. We need smart specialization, not least with regard to the digital economy and innovation. And we need to have a smart cooperation that allows for both strong governance, public-private dialogue, and regular adjustments to the international environment. Let me briefly just touch upon the last point. I welcome very much the Commission's report on governance of the EU strategy for the Baltic Sea. It is a good and timely contribution. Although the strategy is only a few years old, it is important to continuously discuss how to get the most out of it. I look forward to the discussions in tomorrow's session on the strategy. It is regrettable that we do not have the CBSS prime ministers present at this discussion. We need political leadership to set the course, and we also need to make sure that funds are set aside to finance the strategy according to the commitments. We also need a simple bureaucratic setup and simple procedures, and the dialogue with the private sector is part of the regional development. Smart specialization is a way to ensure that we become better in the sectors when we are already at the forefront. As Christian Ketels underlies, it is important that the different locations are able to display international competences in key sectors in order to attract investors, researchers, and business. In other words, we have to establish stronger clusters. It is a way to boost innovation, growth, and prosperity by focusing on our region's strongholds. Smart specialization is a way to attract more investments to the region's strongholds. The ICT digital economy is one important sector to specialize in. This afternoon, Baltic Development Forum and Microsoft are launching an ICT report, searching for the micro multinationals, on the barriers and opportunities of SMEs in the ICT sector and on the challenges they face when they want to grow. The countries around the Baltic Sea have established themselves as front runners in many aspects of the ICT sector and have succeeded in attracting huge foreign direct investment in recent years. We are among the world leaders in ICT, but with still tough global competition, we must work hard to maintain our leading position. I look very much forward to our discussions this afternoon together with the Finnish and the Estonian prime ministers and high-level representatives of the industries on this issue. The ICT report will also mark the official launch of BDF's think tank, Top of Digital Europe, where we will set up together with Microsoft and supported by Siemens. We will invite business, governments, and everybody else interested to join our efforts in making the digital sector a focus area for smart specialization. Finally, we need to be a smart region with smart cities in order to grow together in a sustainable manner. The urban areas of the Baltic Sea region are already making the transition towards smart and resource-efficient societies. Our cities and regions are growth centers, leading the way for sustainable solutions in energy, in climate, and environment. But we need the commitments of all actors, both public and private, to succeed. Tomorrow, BDF will present a new report titled Making Water Your Business, which shares different companies' experience in working with responsible water management. The report shows that our region is home to companies that are true front runners in the field, going beyond legal compliance to become a driving force in the development of new tools, strategies, and partnership on water stewardship. It also shows that responsible water management is good business that can mitigate risk, cut down on cost, build trust with consumers and decision makers, and provide a competitive advantage. Without water, there is no business at all. As such, water stewardship is not only good for business, it is also common sense. And we hope that it can give new inspiration to the exchange best practices across the region. This is part of being a smart region, and BDF is certainly committed to this end. All of the BDF reports are addressing key aspects of growing together and growing smart. They can provide a good basis for the discussions during the coming 2 days, giving us guidance, new ideas, and inspiration on how to realize the vision for the Baltic Sea region as one of the most competitive, innovative, and dynamic regions in the EU and in the world. To use a well-known slogan, yes, we can. I wish you all a successful summit. Thank you.
Thank you, Lena, for not only setting the bar high, but also feeding us with a little bit of realism that it's not just going on business as usual, but there's some new challenges to be met to ensure that growth continues to grow at a good pace instead of a slow pace. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Mayor Randell and Minister Vapaavuori, Commissioner Hahn, Lena, thank you very much.
Now we won't let you have a coffee break just yet, quite the opposite. We want you to exercise a little bit.
A little bit.
Because I don't know about you, but when I arrived in Turku, I was struck by two things. First of all, the Kiss My Turku posters, which are really great. You know, this kind of sense of humor is extremely unique. Yes. And then the fact that a lot of people exercise. So we prepared a small exercise for us to warm up for the next discussion.
Exactly. It's a bit of a warm-up. It's not a physical warm-up, but it's a bit of a mental warm-up to make sure that you're engaged. I mentioned in my introduction that I'm a researcher, so I've been asking a lot of questions to a lot of different companies and research organizations over the past several years, and I thought I'd take the opportunity with such an audience full of wisdom to ask you to conduct a little survey here in the audience. I'm going to ask a series of yes or no questions, and the idea is to raise your hand if your opinion on the question is yes. Okay. So, do you think that the general business climate and economic performance of the region has improved since last year? Maybe about 20%? Okay. Do you feel that the political climate of the region has improved since last year?
Okay.
I see zero there. Do you perceive that the countries of the region are becoming more intertwined, that cohesion is strengthening? That's good news. So Commissioner Hahn's a challenge to talk about this. We can meet that. Do you think that progress has been made in implementing the Baltic Sea region's macro-regional strategy? Also about half, I'd say. Do you feel optimistic about the future of this region? Oh, this is good. This is about 80%, I would say. Is the Finnish coffee adequately strong in your taste? A little bit less than half, I'd say. How about this one? Do you think it was a fair result of the European Song Contest that the winner was from the Danube region?
I mean, this winner?
This year's? Yeah, that's about 20%. All right, I hope you're adequately warmed up. I'm going to hand the floor over to Pavel to introduce our next session.
To rephrase Emily's question, would we want Skončitavurst to be a Baltic region national or not? Well, to respond to your coffee question, I arrived 20 past midnight, so I would need a double espresso, and I will look for one during the break. Thanks very much. I think we had a pretty clear overview of where we are in the region, with a lot of optimism, but with a realistic assessment of especially the politics, and we know why. But also the economics. To guide us through the economic state of the region, I would now like to invite two people who are not only veterans of the Baltic Development Forum summits, but they are also studious examiners of where the region is heading. Dr. Christian Ketels and Helge Pedersen. Christian is a professor of the Harvard Business School, and Helge Pedersen is chief economist of Nordea. They've been authoring for years now a flagship report called The State of the Region. And the main value added of this report, except for its minute detail, which is valuable in itself, is that it's open and honest. That's at least the way I've always found the reports. So there is not going to be any cream on the top unless we deserve it. But Christian, where are we?
Pavel, thank you very much. Well, thank you all for the opportunity to be here this morning. Actually, thank you a lot to the Baltic Development Forum, because usually we do this as the warm-up before the start of the event. But maybe it's because I'm getting older that Hans thought, you know, well, we can't have him go up that early in the morning. It's great to be here again. It's great to be here as commissioner. Hahn said, you know, a couple of things seem to return every year. The report is one of them, hopefully a good thing that it comes back. But there are also some new things. And one thing that I am particularly happy about is that I'm not alone on the stage this time. So you see three names there behind me. So I'm very happy to still be involved with the State of the Region report this year again. But then I have with me Helge Pedersen from Nordea. I'm very happy to have him join me, and he will in a minute talk a little bit about the economic climate in our region. And then we also have Timo Suma from Aalto University. He can't be with us today, but we've tried to create a Danish, Finnish, German, Swedish team appropriate for this region, and hopefully a good platform for us to discuss over the next couple of days. So I'll now hand over to Helge to talk about the current climate in the region, and then I'll try to talk a little bit more about the medium to long-term trends. Helge, floor is yours.
Thank you. Christian, thank you for the kind introduction and also for the invitation to me to participate in the State of the Region report this year. I was told that this should work, and it does. This is a smart city. It's not always that it works out in this way. But I'm here to speak about the economic climate in the Baltic Sea region. And just to mention a few words also about the world economic outlook, because it matters for all of us. And it is that over the past year or so, we have seen that the world growth to a larger extent than earlier on has been driven by the advanced economies. It's the US, it's also now the Eurozone, it's the UK, it's Japan, which actually is driven growth in the world. On the contrary, the BRIC countries, emerging markets, seems to have problems right now. They're actually struggling quite a bit, and that can, of course, also have a big impact, since the Chinese economy for a number of years has been the economy which has been driving growth in the world, and it has had also an important impact, for instance, on the Russian economy and the Brazilian economy, these commodity economies being so dependent on a huge market in China. If we look at the BSR, the Baltic Sea region, then it still looks more promising than the rest of Europe. But there are fragilities also there. And again, we have to mention the conflict ongoing between Ukraine and Russia. It will have an impact on our region as well. But in our baseline scenario, we still see that the Baltics will do relatively well this year, particularly Latvia and Lithuania. Estonia is having some problems also because of the fact that the Finnish economy is still struggling to get growth going. And actually, I can tell you that in Nordea, we are revealing a new economic forecast for the Finnish economy tomorrow. And there we actually foresee that the Finnish economy will be in the third consecutive year of a recession. Among the other countries in the region, the Swedish economy will probably do very well this year. And the Swedish economy is one of the larger, as we heard early on. And that can also act as a kind of growth engine to some of the other Nordic countries. We are particularly pleased that the German economy is doing so well. Germany is the growth locomotive, so to speak, of the whole of Europe. And not least in the case of Poland, the Polish economy is mirroring the German one. So when Germany is doing well, Poland will do as well. And then, as mentioned, the conflict has already led to kind of stagnation in the Russian economy, also because of the severe capital flight we have seen from Russia over the past few months. So Russian stagnation and maybe even recession this year. The geopolitical risk, I don't want to speak more about them, but as mentioned, there is a risk that they will lead to further economic dampening in the region, not least in the countries being very close to Russia and Ukraine. And I mean, if we look at the situation in Southern Europe, they really don't give a damn about the situation. If you're Portugal, Russia, Ukraine, doesn't matter much. If you live in the Baltic Sea region, it does matter a lot. The fact that growth is still relatively weak and inflation is indeed very low, unemployment rate is high in the Eurozone, means that we will see a very lenient monetary policy for a long time yet. Our expectation is actually that the European Central Bank will cut interest rates on Thursday by another 10, maybe 15 basis points. And that, of course, will help the situation economically, since it will mean reduced lending rates also for households and companies throughout Europe. Looking at the numbers, the GDP numbers for the region, again, in the baseline scenario, you can see the Baltic Sea region here, the dark blue one. We expect growth close to 2% in 2014 and 15. The risks are on the downside right now, which is still better than what we see in the rest of the European Union countries. Still, the region is lagging the development amongst the NAFTA countries, the North American Free Trade Association. The economic sentiment, which is measuring on a monthly basis the sentiment amongst households and corporates in Europe, you can see here the Baltic Sea region actually used to do better than the rest of EU for a number of years. Over the past few months, the sentiment has worsened in our region, and that is not least due to, again, Russia-Ukraine conflicts, which has had a negative impact. When we see this very steep increase in the European Union sentiment indicator as such, it's not least due to the fact that the South European countries are in a much better economic position now than they were just 1 year ago. But the economic sentiment, as mentioned, is worsening a bit in our region now, again, due to the geopolitical situation. I mentioned earlier on that the high unemployment rate in the Eurozone is likely to make the ECB cut rates on Thursday. And as you can see, the unemployment, oops, back again. It's still early in the morning. You can see the unemployment rate in the Euro and the Eurozone is close to 12%, and the European Union is around 11%. Our region is actually doing very well, and we should bear in mind that a country like Germany is having an unemployment rate of only 5% now, down from 13%, and also in Norway, which is a part of our region, the unemployment rate is indeed very low. It's still not as low as in the US and Canada and Mexico seen as a whole, but still it is relatively low. Not to say that there are not any kind of problems related to that, and not anything to work with for our politicians, because youth unemployment still poses a huge problem in many countries. As you can see on this slide, in countries like Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, the youth unemployment rate is above 25%. It's not as much as in Southern Europe, where Greece and Spain are still experiencing youth unemployment rates of more than 50%, but it's still very high, and there is still a risk of a massive migration from these countries onto other countries, maybe within the region, but it still poses a potential growth problem for these countries that youth unemployment rate is as high as it is. So still a lot of work to do for our politicians to improve the situation. One of the really good things about our region is that it's having a very low public debt. Due to good economic governance, the public debt in our region as such is, oh my God, this is a difficult question.
There we go.
You have brought your glasses. I should have brought mine. This is the pointer. The public debt is way below the 60% threshold from the European Union. It is actually the best among our peer group, much, much lower than the EU as such. And this is, of course, also something which comes to the benefit of governments, households, corporates, when they are loaning money in the banks. They can do it at interest rates which are much lower than, for instance, in the South European countries. So this is definitely a very good situation for our region. And if we look at a kind of a misery, an economic misery index, which actually is the sum, the unweighted sum of the unemployment rate, the inflation rate, the public sector deficit, and the current account deficits, then you can see that our region is actually the best in class. The Baltic Sea region is having, in that sense, literally no economic misery compared to, for instance, NAFTA and the European Union as such. So economic fundamentals in the Baltic Sea region are indeed very good. What we actually like now is to get growth going. We have heard that before. We are a competitive region, blah, blah, blah. But still, we need to see growth be going. And just to mention a few words about why growth is so important, because there are many discussions now. Do we need to grow more? I mean, in my own country, Denmark, now people, they are talking, do we need to? No, we don't want to consume more. We have enough, blah, blah. But actually, growth is important, because without growth, we will not create new jobs. And we will not lay the foundation for welfare economies in the future. In case our region grows by, say, 2% a year, which probably is the potential growth rate for the Baltic Sea region, it takes around 35 years to double the GDP, to double the welfare level in our region. If we only grow by 1%, there will be created no new jobs, and it will take more than 70 years for the region to double its GDP. That's the reason it is so extremely important to get growth going. Actually, I do not have the answer right now on how to make that happen, Christian. But I think that you...
We can't give the answer before the end of the conference, of course, but we'll try. We'll work together.
But I think that that you maybe can give
thank
the
you.
View on the state of the competitiveness in our region.
Well, thank you very much. So Helge...
thank you.
Helge talked a little bit about the current temperature of the region. Actually, there was at least one good thing, Paweł. I think we can agree that it's a good news that if things are good for Germany, that they're also good for Poland. It was not always like that in our region. So, you know, at least there's one thing we can build on. But what are the more medium-term trends? You know, is there hope for further growth in our region? So let's take a quick look at some of the data that you'll find in the report. So first of all, I think it is important to really remind ourselves how deep of a hole this crisis has dug, not only for us, for the rest of Europe, also for North America. So on this graph, you see the permanent prosperity loss from the crisis. And it turns out that this crisis was not just a bump in the road, that you recover, you have a quick return of investments and so on, and you're getting back onto your growth track. But we both lost the production of these years, and we seem to have turned on a lower growth path. So we're kind of permanently growing at a lower rate than we used to before. This is particularly evident for the EU27. It also has had an impact on the Baltic Sea region, and to a more limited degree, also North America. What that means is for Europe, that the convergence to the higher prosperity levels of the US has stopped. In fact, the gap is increasing again, something that we haven't seen historically for the last couple of years. The Baltic Sea region, which is still at a lower level of prosperity, is now growing at about the same pace as North America. So we are getting closer and closer to the EU27 average. That's good, but we're not growing as fast as we used to before. Now, one of the things that is really positive about the Baltic Sea region is that within our regions, we continue to see convergence happening. Our region is, although we always talk about, you know, the happy family that we all are, is a region of heterogeneity. We have very prosperous countries and regions, but we also have regions that are far behind. Now, what we've been seeing is that the regions that are less prosperous in our regions have been growing faster. And this is a process that has continued despite the crisis, and it has continued after the crisis. If you look at these same graphs for the EU27 and the EU15, it shows that convergence is not automatic. If we look at Europe overall, we see this process flattening out. The poorest regions in Europe are not at the moment catching up to the prosperity levels of the rich regions. This is happening within our part of the world. So we have created an environment through regional collaboration that allows the less prosperous parts of our regions to catch up, to grow faster, and to increase their levels of prosperity. That's a good thing. Now, the report this year talks about the new normal. What is that? Well, if you look about the new normal and the growth path that you can expect in your region, it makes sense to look back at what are the key drivers that support growth and prosperity over time. And in a strict mathematical sense, that growth and prosperity has to come from one out of two things. Either you're becoming more productive, generating more output for each hour that you work, or we're able to get more people to work and engage in creating economic output that ultimately translates into prosperity. Now, if you look here to your left, you see that both the blue, the labor mobilization, and the green, the labor productivity, made a significant contribution to prosperity growth in our region before the crisis. Both of them were higher than in Europe and in North America. What happened after the crisis? Well, we've seen that labor mobilization as a source of growth has basically come to a standstill. So we have a situation where our labor markets are not generating more labor input. And looking at our demographics, looking at the labor market situation, I think it's not very likely that we're going to see a very strong uptick in labor market mobilization over the next couple of years. And then you see the green bar, the labor productivity, and there we have seen that it's still positive, but somewhat lower than before. That is largely driven because we have less investment in our economy. And that's something that we might be able to discuss in the next day or two. Why is there so little investment in Europe? Is it because of the macroeconomic policy uncertainty? Is it because of other reasons? We do see, however, that this bar has gone down, and that really drives the lower growth rate over the next couple of years. Now, we're now at the same level of North America, where the growth rate also has gone down, and a lot of my American colleagues are kind of puzzled by that process. We're expecting to see higher labor productivity growth. It's not happening. It's even lower in the EU15, which in addition has to deal with much more difficult labor market situation. So the new normal means that our standard rate of growth, abstracting from the cyclical events of kind of catching up and falling behind, seems to be lower than we've seen in the past. We're not getting poorer, but we're not adding prosperity as quickly as before. Now, for our part of the world, where we have a lot of small open economies, internationalization, our engagement with the global economy, is a very key part of what has allowed us to increase prosperity so much in the past. And here again, unfortunately, the outlook is not that great. If you look here to the left of the graph, you see how our exports have been rising a lot in the first half of the last decade. So both services, as we heard about from Lena earlier on, but also our goods exports, in line with global trade. We lost a little bit world market share, but we still increased our absolute level of exports. Now then there was the great disruption of the crisis, but since then it seems like we are now leveling out in terms of overall exports. So we can't expect a lot of push from the external economy anymore. And importantly, this is not just because we're getting worse on international markets, it's also because we see much less dynamism in terms of global world trade. I'll get back to that at the end. Now, the other side of internationalization is foreign direct investment. And as we discussed in the previous reports, the internationalization model of many of our economies in the Baltic Sea region is, in fact, much more investment-driven than export-driven. So a lot of our companies go abroad, they invest abroad, and they serve foreign markets from production sites elsewhere. We still see here, that's the green line, that our FDI outflows have been very constant. You know, we're participating in foreign investment flows globally. We are losing a little bit gradually in terms of inward investment. And I think that's something that we need to continue to watch at. We are still attractive because people see this part of the world as a laboratory for new ideas, a lot of information technology, and I think it's a great initiative of the forum to look at those issues. But that's not a lot of money. It's usually a couple of people, it's kind of exploration, it's a representative office, it's maybe a small laboratory. We need to have an eye on that to see that this gap is not widening further. Behind that, of course, is competitiveness. Kind of what's the underlying strength of our economies? The skills of our workers, the strengths of our infrastructure, the efficiency of our regulations, the strength and dynamism of our clusters. Now, if you look at those long-term factors, you still see our region very strong. So here to the right is the competitiveness score for 2013, which tries to bake this all into one number. And you see our countries very high up there, most of them. In fact, Finland, in our data, still comes out as number one, which is somewhat of a puzzle. So we have an imbalance here between a Finnish economy that is in macroeconomic difficulties, where the outlook really is not very positive, but the underlying data on competitiveness is still very strong. Now, this makes me optimistic that there is a lot of potential in the Finnish economy to regain growth, to really re-engage with the global economy. But we also should understand that there is no room for complacency. If the macroeconomic situation is bad, companies are not reinvesting, there is no modernization is happening, it's very easy to lose that position. You are losing track if you're not able to move ahead on those conditions. Now let's look a little bit at this kind of heat map of where the region is strong, where the region is less strong in terms of underlying competitiveness. We still see, and that is something that Helge has already pointed out, that the macroeconomic context, both the quality of our institutions, the level of trust, but also the macroeconomic policy, in terms of fiscal and monetary policy, is very strong in this region. This is one of our key assets, and an asset that has really helped us to weather the crisis better than any other parts of Europe. But we do have challenges in our business environment. Part of those challenges in terms of our openness, in terms of our intensity of local competition, in terms of the depth and dynamism of our clusters, is related to our relatively small size. It's not only that we're overall not a huge region, you know, we're not the size of the German economy, but we're also a region of relatively small countries. And while we collaborate, there are still boundaries and borders, and I think we'll hear from the business people later on that they still look at each country as its own market. They don't look at one integrated Baltic Sea region market. That's one of the challenges that we're seeing reflected in some of these numbers. Let me just look at two of the issues a little bit more. One of them is what the World Bank calls their doing business indicators, which is really government regulation. How is government regulation affecting business? And this is particularly interesting, not because it's the entirety of competitiveness, but because these are things that politicians can change relatively quickly. It doesn't cost much to change the laws. It might be politically difficult. But this is kind of self-inflicted. And what we see is, you know, overall, we rank quite well, but some of our countries don't. And on some of the indicators, we could do much better. In terms of getting credit, protecting investors, financial market issues, but also starting a business. We know we need more dynamism so that we don't rank very high on the regulations affecting new businesses is like we're shooting ourselves in the foot, and I don't really understand why. This is an area where we could do much more. The World Bank last year did a study on Sweden, which usually ranks very high. You see Sweden here on 14. And I think they had very pointed suggestions on what a country that ranks very high on competitiveness can do much better in many of these areas. And I think that might be something to look at. It's in the report as well, maybe something for the other countries in our region to look at. Now, the other issue is education. We know that education is only going to become more important over the next couple of years. And somewhat surprisingly, this is an area where there's also a lot of heterogeneity in our region. We are here in Finland, and Finland, of course, is a world leader in terms of its performance and educational outcomes. And I think that, again, makes me more optimistic about the outlooks for the Finnish economy. But the country where I now live in Sweden ranks very poorly and is actually going down. We should be able, in the Baltic Sea region, to collaborate, to share our experiences, to learn more from each other. We're culturally similar enough that this should be possible. There should be no reason for these huge differences in terms of performance that you see. Now, what are the things that are going to affect us as we look forward? Globalization is continually going to change the way that businesses organize value chains and how they're competing. As I mentioned, we're going to see that world trade is probably not going to rise as quickly as it has over the last couple of years. A lot of people that argue that the potential is going down, we have less energy, we have higher energy costs, and maybe also the liberalization trend is going down. Knowledge-driven economy will see more value of education and skills as an area where you have a lot of potential. And environmental sustainability, which again is a market opportunity, but also a huge investment requirement for us in this region to reform our energy systems, to reorganize many of our economic activity in our countries. Demographics and urbanization are other factors that we have to have a look at. Demographics look better in our part of the world than most of the rest of Europe. Urbanization is more of a challenge. We know that cities are a key driver of growth. We are a region of very small cities. But we do see urbanization increasing even in our part of the world. Now, finally, and really more just as a teaser for the later discussions in this conference, we already heard from Commissioner Hahn about the communication on governance in our region. We've been talking about competitiveness and collaboration in the Baltic Sea regions for many years. Now, for the last 5 years, we've had the EU strategy for the Baltic Sea region, and I think it has done a lot. It has aligned what the Commission is doing with what the nations in our region are doing, with what many of the NGOs and individual regions and projects are doing. But what we still lack is a clear structure. There's a lot of bottom-up activity that now goes in the same direction. We're like a flock of birds that now move together. Well, we don't necessarily have the determination and the top-down leadership that enables us to deal with these challenges that we see ahead of ourselves. So I think as we look forward, we know this journey of the Baltic Sea region will continue. And I think we can look at that with something that I think is appropriate for us, which is confidence, but not exuberance. Thank you. Oh.
Thank you, Christian and Helge. The American in me is a little bit downtrodden by this confidence, but not exuberance. That makes it tough, but it also is, as the introductory addresses, it sets the bar at a pace where it's like, okay, so how do we address this? What kind of things can we do? There is not enough time for Pavel and I to pose any questions, but instead we are going to welcome up on stage four commentators, additional speakers. We have Petri Parvinen, professor in the Department of Marketing from Aalto University here in Finland. And we have Anita Fürstenberg-Lucius, director at the European Investment Bank. I think they're all appearing now. Great. We have Janne Ehrman, the CEO of Siemens Finland, also working with the Baltic countries. And we have Thomas Bostrup, the deputy director general of the Confederation of Danish Industry. Thank you very much. What's the first question?
Thank you very much, Emily. So we have had a splendid overview, and the picture is mixed. I think both when it comes to the way we compare ourselves to the United States, that has been our traditional point of reference, but also the divergences within the region remain to be addressed. So we want to go with our speakers area by area, and maybe I will start with Anita Fürstenberg-Lucius. If you could tell us about the investment situation, because Christian has pointed out to a very clear lack of investments in the region. If you could tell us about how you assess the reasons for that, and also what the European Investment Bank is doing to remedy that situation. It's up to you. You can speak. You have a microphone, so you can either speak from the podium or from the chair. That applies to all the speakers. By the way, we still have this Twitter hashtag, hashtag BSR 2014 EU. So all the groundbreaking observations that you want to share with the outside world, please use that hashtag. Anita.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, Professor Ketels and Professor Pedersen, for the very insightful State of the Region report. I think we have enough food for thought for our annual gathering. And it's very interesting to see how the investment dynamics work in the Baltic Sea region. I would like to quickly touch upon three of the macro trends that you mentioned and describe the initiatives the European Investment Bank is doing to address these issues. Let me maybe quickly say a few facts about the European Investment Bank. We have lent last year 72 billion euros, and this was a very special year as we increased our lending in 37%. Now, the Baltic Sea region alone was recipient of 11 billion euros last year. We, as the Bank of the European Union, are committed to support projects that deliver sustainable economic, social, and environmental benefits. So this is at the focus of our interventions. Now, the three macro trends that I would see that are happening in the medium term in the region, the first one that I would like to touch upon is energy, because after the latest events in Russia and Ukraine, the security of energy and the energy policy has become top of the agenda again. Now, having been at this forum already for the past years, we have been discussing energy policy, I think, at every forum. So basically, we know what kind of projects are there, what needs to be done. But what I see is going to happen in the near future is that the decision-making process to bring these projects closer, the political decision-making process is going to be faster because of the events that are happening around us. In the last year, the European Investment Bank has already been financing a couple of these cross-border energy projects that are so important for the region, and I just want to mention some. There is a 650 megawatt undersea power cable linking Estonia and Finland, which we supported with 75 million euros. This will almost triple the capacity between the two countries. Another important development is liquid natural gas import facilities, which have been being constructed around the region. The first LNG terminal was the terminal in Gdansk, but last year we also concluded the financing for the liquefied gas terminal in Lithuania. And there are more projects to come. There is plans for a LNG terminal in the Baltic Sea region, in Estonia or Finland or both countries. With the two LNG terminals that are already been built, the capacity that's now available or that will be available once the Lithuanian terminal will come on stream is 9 billion cubic meters of gas. Now, just to put this in comparison, the whole EU LNG imports in 2012 were 58 billion cubic meters. So these are significant investments to ensure that there is enough gas? Should there be an interruption of gas supply, or should there be just to have an alternative if energy needs increase? Also on the renewable energy side, there have been developments. We've been financing a wind farm in Margonin in northwest of Poland, and that will be a significant contribution for Poland's aim to reach a 20% generation of electricity from renewable sources by 2020. As I said, energy policy is long-term. There is not going to be a quick fix to the divergent energy needs of the region and the connection between the different countries. This will take years, but what is important now is that the decisions to have better connection of the energy field, these decisions are being taken quickly. The second point that I want to just quickly touch upon is what Professor Ketels said in his last issue, it's urbanization. We at the European Investment Bank see huge investments being done by the city centers in the region to cope with these increased urbanization trends. And just to name two main projects in the Nordics, we've been financing, for example, a 600 million loan for the to increase the computer train capacity in Stockholm. We will fund the construction of an underground railway line through a 6-kilometer tunnel. Also, 450 million euros went into a 14-kilometer metro line linking central Helsinki to Espoo, which will provide capacity for 100,000 passengers per day between these two cities. Also, we have been creating a 227 million euro fund for energy efficiency projects in Lithuania, mainly on the housing side. And the pipeline for 2014 is full. So if you ask where investment will go, we see a lot of investments, public sector spending in the metropolitan areas just to cope with this increased influx of population into the cities that are constructed too small for these new sizes they're going to have better transport links and to have a smarter growth in the cities. And the third point that I quickly want to touch upon is something that has become, I think, very visible also after the recent European Parliament elections. We have growth in the region. The growth is a very prosperous region, but that doesn't mean that every individual is better off. So we have populations in the region that are not taking part in this prosperity gain. And one of these groups, one of the important groups that was also mentioned by Professor Pedersen, are the young unemployed. This is, of course, the scale of the problem in the Baltic Sea region is not at all as high as it would be in Greece or Spain, but nevertheless, it is a problem in some of the countries. And we have therefore launched in 2013 a skills and job investing for youth initiative to complement youth employment programs in the European Union. This is the bank's first ever dedicated lending program to specifically support young people. And I'm very happy to announce that we just a couple of weeks ago concluded the first of these financings in Poland. We've provided 50 million euros to Europejski Fundus Leasingowa SA to support small and medium-sized enterprises that provide youth employment in various sectors in Poland. Let me close on a positive note. This region is a prosperous one. I think all indications are pointing in the direction that it is going to continue to be a very prosperous region. It is on the top of Europe. This region can be in the pole position to develop smart, inclusive, sustainable cities, and that also find innovative approaches to deal with education and employment creation, in particular for the young generation. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Anita, for pointing out some of these important points to remember about focus on long-term investments, in particular in the area of energy policy and transport connections, and also raising the topic of youth unemployment. There's other areas of the economy that one can take advantage of, making opportunities out of mobilizing other groups in the labor market. I'm going to turn to Petri now and ask you to comment a little bit on the report in general, but in particular on the comment made of the little bit of the ironic results and the figures for Finland. And the macro impression is that things are maybe on a decline, but then micro indicators pointing to long-term competitive optimism for Finland. And we heard from the minister the mention of these investments in LNG, and maybe are you doing the right investments to ensure this long-term? What's the secret? What are you doing in Finland?
Well, thanks a lot. Thanks for the organizers, and thanks for the great report, and thanks for the good news. Super competitiveness, right, in the region, even if there are no other sources of competitiveness except for the macroeconomic environment that we have. You know, it's a bit of a puzzle. The perspective that I'm looking at this from is one of small and medium-sized companies, of new ventures and new businesses. We do international research in academia on what makes a new business fly. I've also founded 14 companies myself. So I can proudly ask, who's been bankrupt here? You know, 18,000 is the number of export-intensive small and medium-sized businesses in Finland alone. These 18,000 companies are what makes this economic region, from the Finnish perspective, run. They are the ones who bring in the exports, the injections of foreign capital into this country, that hire the people in small increments that make growth run. And really, to be able to run policies, we need to look at these companies and their abilities to survive. One of the greatest things that I see from this report and what I've seen around me is that we have the ability to bounce back from recessions, right? We are able to implement structural changes, create internal efficiencies within the market, like the economists would say, but also companies are able to renew their business models and actually invent new businesses. We have sufficient diversity in the region so that we actually have a sort of a regional domestic market with some benefits and specialization. I'll take the forest industry as an example. It's been a bit of a struggle for the forest industry in Northern Europe during the past 5 or 6 years. During the last year, in Finland alone, massive domestic investments into biodiesel, bioproduction with a cellulose angle, and packaging. All businesses driven by the new digital era. Not old businesses, but new businesses. Billions of euros of investment. Who's going to do the job? It's the youth. 19% level of youth unemployment in this area. With the best practice in Norway being a fraction of that. Things can be done, and the youth are the people who are going to take over the companies founded by their parents who are now born in the 40s, born in the 50s. It is key to keep these people running the companies on a growth track. You need to educate these people on a global growth scenario, not on a do-it-yourself scenario. We need to teach people, young entrepreneurs, how to make money without saving money. Because that is the new normal. That is the growth path that we're seeing. People are taking their money and putting it away, keeping it to themselves and for their children, buying houses a little bit here and there, traveling more and more, but it's not creating investments that would make the regional economy tick. The youth, they need to know how. The only thing that they really know, looking from a business school and a sort of educational perspective, is that they do not want to work the same way their parents did. They do not want to become similar entrepreneurs. We need to teach them a new way of living an entrepreneurial growth life without sacrificing in the same way that the post-war generation did. You don't have to go far in the macroeconomic reports to see where the growth is. It's in service exports and it's in the managed services of industrial companies. It's also in the industrial internet, but it's not here yet. We need to help businesses renew their human resource protocols first, and then renew their business models with the new people to be able to bring in new kinds of service and digitalization-led growth into traditional industrial businesses that still dominate not only exports, but the local economy here to a large extent. It's not all about games and music. It's about doing business well in the areas that the region does politics well, right? We are great at certain political systems, political angles, infrastructure, energy, transport, roads, education. We've already seen the first things of Nordic or Baltic education being taken to the places where there is money and growth in the world. Healthcare, should it be pharmaceuticals, bio, hospitals? We can totally make that a regional export intensive area. And the outdoor industry. You can look at the forest as timber, you can look at it as pulp and paper, you can look at it as nanofiber, but you can also look at it as outdoors. Everybody from the US has seen the reports where the outdoor industry is already 70% of the finance and banking and insurance industry. 70%. And it's grown the fastest during the past 15 years. And a lot of it is export. So, you know, the success in the service-oriented service export business, you know, it comes from dynamic employment. It doesn't come from fixed investments, it comes out of labor. So the really the struggle and the competitiveness angle is one of labor. How to make the price of labor competitive, how to educate people into the right professions, how to make people not repeat what other people did in the past in their careers, but to create an entrepreneurial angle that people want to do. Again, the forest industry, one of the most traditional industries, is a very good example. Harvesting and making harvesters is all about IT. Their crux of their competitiveness is their in-house 250 people in the harvester-making companies here in Finland. You look at renewable energy, it's about consumer data. You look at cellulosa or infrastructure at land at sea, it's about global trends and adhering to the new trends of global commuting, new trends of global business travel. Even with small continuous growth, we will still need to be humble in the face of changing face of labor. There will be a social divide, and it's very apparent in your report, right? There will be a social divide between the knowledge-intensive business workers and then what you guys called as elementary occupations. Those are the two that are growing. The era of the skilled worker is sort of over. Also, the youth don't want that. They either want an easy life or they want a very challenging modern life, but they do not want to repeat the same things as their parents did. That's in biology. Germany and Sweden are above everybody else here in talent attraction, right? We have a best practice benchmark in the area. Instead of saying, you know, maybe Germany should, you know, help everybody else a little, maybe we should just copy what Germany does well. I think on the talent attraction side, Germany has taken enormous steps during the past 10 or 15 years, and the Baltic Sea region can learn from that. You know, I'm very delighted to be a part of a very positive, forward-looking event. It's looking good. The sentiment on average is on the rise, and where does it rise from more so than from great events where a lot of people go home and say, I had a great time, and do something inspirational. Thanks.
Petri. Petri, thank you very much. We are very close to St. Petersburg, where some revolutions have started in the past, but this sounded pretty revolutionary to me, and I cannot resist the temptation to ask our economist in charge for their take of this proposition, that growth is going to come out of labor and not investment, that we should basically embrace this new normal in which people are not going to save, so we want to have the sources of investment. What is your take, Christian, Helge?
Maybe I'll start. I mean, I completely agree. I think growth will look different in the future. It will be much more knowledge-based assets rather than the, you know, the brick and mortar that we are used to. But we still need that type of investment, even if it will look different. And I think right now we're in a phase where that investment isn't happening enough either. So we need to find that new approach, and I think our region has a lot of assets to build on in that context. But we need to think through how we need to change our systems. You know, I mean, like the business regulation, I think, is a worry if we make it hard for new companies to start. In fact, you know, I think we've been not that bad in creating startups. We've been much worse in letting startups grow. And this is where the jobs are, and this is where we need to do more. So, you know, I think this is a good inspiration and direction to go into.
Helge, anything to add?
I completely agree on that. Again, we need to have more job creation for sure. As Christian also mentioned, we have a demographic burden, which is quite cumbersome, and it needs to take a lot of investment, fixed business investment, to ensure that we can raise productivity to the level that also our region can grow in the future. And that is my big worry, and now we have heard about the lack of investments in our region, and to my mind, it is quite clear that the Baltic Sea region as such is indeed very competitive, but what focus is on right now when it comes to a particular large corporates, it is shareholder value and its cost efficiency. So to my mind, it's obvious that the high cost level, in particular in the Scandinavian countries, is the major reason that we do not see the investment activity, which is important to make our region run in the future. And I don't know how we can solve that problem, but it is imminent to me that it is the cost level which is in focus now. Before the crisis, we could compete on quality, made in, blah, 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 all these soft things. Now it is hardcore business, it's about prices. And when we are in a crisis, it is buyer's markets. We know that. So the cost efficiency is important. And here, the smart industries can really take a place, how we, through the digital revolution, can make productivity increase so that our cost competitiveness, again, can be enforced.
Thank you very much, Helge. And I want to turn to Janne now, who runs the Siemens operation in Finland. When you heard this passionate plea for the SMEs and for the service sector to build the future growth, where are some shivers going down your spine? Where is the growth going to come from in the Baltic Sea region?
Thank you. May I borrow this special device of yours?
Absolutely.
Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, the standards of living and quality of life are very good in the Baltic Sea region. When compared to most of the world, to maintain this level or even develop the quality of life, it's vital that we are able to keep the successful industry in the region. This requires the adoption of new technologies and processes as well as competitive infrastructure. Economic growth is a must for well-being. Economic growth requires successful industry. In general, the growth of Baltic Sea region is based on export industries. The region consists of small and medium-sized economies which are dependent on foreign trade. Nearly one-fifth of the global GDP and over two-thirds of export comes from industry. In Finland, for example, the shares are even greater. In the Baltic states, the industry share of the GDP is over a quarter. Industry also creates jobs to other fields of society. One industry creates, for example, as many as two others. Additionally, industry promotes innovation. All the Baltic Sea region countries' industry faces shared challenges. New competition, global value chains, and market transparency form obstacles for industry in the region. Industry needs to be taken to a center stage of political agenda in all the countries in the region. Will to promote industry is one of the fundamentals of its success. The role of the political decision makers is vital. For example, in securing competitive infrastructure. They also influence on business environment. Laws, for example, need to adapt quickly to new needs and enable new types of business models. Requirements of success: digitalization and quick adaptation of new technologies. The private sector can take part in building successful industry in the Baltic Sea region. Businesses need to be on the leading edge to be pioneers in adapting new technologies and processes. They need to be brave and yearn to be pioneers in their industries to invest in the future. Competitive industry needs to be efficient, fast, and flexible. And this can be achieved through substantial adoption of digitalization. It was even chosen as one Siemens strategic orientation in our Vision 2020. Digitalization is also getting recognized as a prerequisite and promoter of economic growth. For example, in Finland, we need to be at the forefront of the next industrial revolution, to be involved in defining what is industry 4.0 or Internet of Things. We need to utilize our strengths in the Baltic Sea region to foster this development. The capabilities in digital engineering should be utilized in the new business development. Together with the innovators, we can be forerunners in digitalizing the infrastructure. We can provide highly automated and smart infrastructure and reliable digital infrastructure for managing big data. The need to be efficient, fast, and flexible will lead industry to not only add automation, but also to digitalize. Software will integrate all phases of product development, manufacturing, and maintenance. Machines and products will organize by themselves. Machines will cooperate automatically, and unfinished products will send the manufacturing process data about itself to enhance productivity. The manufacturing process will largely optimize, develop, and supervise itself. The whole production chain can be simulated there and therefore optimized. Productivity will increase through efficient use of data. The amount of data, big data, will be immense. Cities will be able to utilize digital infrastructure to develop efficiency in public services and to provide flexible platform for creating new businesses. The companies and societies able to utilize increasing amount of data will be the winners. This is where the societies need experts and why the data-driven services will be an enabler of successful industry and opportunity for new businesses in the Baltic Sea region. Two fundamentals of success are production networks and flexible value chains. This can create new opportunities for regional cooperation. Could we develop world-class industry in the Baltic Sea region by combining manufacturing and the logistics? Top-of-the-range industry could be built on expertise shared to different countries of the region. This requires seamless communication, information exchange, and data flow from one system to another. The first step has already been taken in the industry, where design software and automation systems are merging. Digital and real worlds are merging. Networks are important in small economic areas. Digitalization and making use of data are tools for utilizing the strengths of all parties to common good. This increases productivity, efficiency, and flexibility. We can take a step towards even more successful Baltic Sea region when everyone adopts the newest and the most efficient technologies and concentrates on their strengths. The Baltic Sea region has to have competitive infrastructure if its industry is able to adopt new technologies. For digitalization, we will need data centers which are efficient and secure. They will also bring good business opportunities for the region An example of thinking outside of the box is the planned Estonian data valley company. This concept of them combines an efficient data center and power plant production. It can be a pioneer in its digitalization. Another matter through which political systems can influence and develop competitiveness is ensuring reasonably priced and reliable energy. This is even more important in the current political situation. Energy consumption statistics from the Baltic Sea region countries show that energy price, availability, and efficient use are vital competitive factors. Energy networks crossing the region create stability. The Baltic states, for example, are more part of the Nordic energy markets thanks to EstLink 2, as it was already mentioned today, HVDC link between Finland and Estonia. EstLink 2 is also a prime example of cross-border collaboration. One new energy opportunity will be LNG terminals and connecting pipelines, which will enable the import of natural gas from the more varied sources. Good traffic and logistic networks in the area are vital for success. The Rail Baltica rail connection across the Baltic states is one project which needs to be promoted immediately. It is a way to support movement of goods and people within the region and to the rest of Europe. Technologies already exist. EU funding is in place. What is important is for the political decision makers to drive the project forward with the conviction. To implement these actions, the public and private sectors need to work together. We are proud of cooperating with the city of Turku to develop smart city infrastructure. This has created tools for planning and implementing sustainable solutions in the cities. Efficient, fast, and flexible industry will be successful in the future also in the Baltic Sea region. The success will be built on advantages of digitalization and competitive infrastructure. Digitalization is prerequisite for new types of cooperation, efficient manufacturing, and development of infrastructure. Success needs to be smart and pioneering technologies and the wisdom to use them efficiently. This is why I hope courage and wisdom to make future-proof decisions from our decision makers. And I hope they will be made quickly so that the Baltic Sea region will gain a competitive edge from being pioneer. So ladies and gentlemen, thanks for your attention. Let's get things done.
Thanks, Janne, for talking a little bit about how Siemens is working with the pioneering new technologies, and you're mentioning the partnership with the Turku, the city of Turku. Before we have our last speaker, Thomas Bustrup, I would like to encourage you all, there will be some minutes, or we will take some few minutes to take questions from the audience. So please be thinking about some things that have been highlighted that you question, or what things have made you, is that really how it is? And prepare some questions, and we'll take a few questions from the audience before we have our break. Thomas, I'm very curious. So we heard from Janne about his view, from Siemens' view of working with public sector and driving change, pioneering new technologies. You also brought up, Janne also brought up the need for these networks of specialized groupings, specialized areas, specialized entities, specialized companies. I'm wondering, for your view with the Confederation of Danish Industries, how do you see these ecosystems of specialized entities working together to solve our challenges that we all experience? Maybe you can address this in your intervention.
Thank you very much. You posed some really, really difficult questions for opening up the speeches, but I hope I will address it somewhere in my presentation. But thank you very much for the organizers also to give me an opportunity to give another business perspective on the report that we have been presented to this morning. But I think I'll also comment a little bit on some of the opening speeches that we heard this morning, because I tend to
agree with Commissioner Hahn when he says that this is a very interesting year, and from where we stand today, it's also more interesting than last year and the year before that, because we are in a transition, a political transition and an economic transition, which also the report shows. I think the political transition, as Chairman Espersen said, we just newly elected our representatives for the coming European Parliament, and good, fair, democratic elections are by definition good, but sometimes the outcome of the elections can be pretty challenging, and this is probably one of them. And as you were also saying, we are in an economic transition where we are coming out of a very tough crisis, global crisis, but also maybe into a new economic scenario where, as you mentioned, some of the Western, strong Western economies, US, Japan, Germany, we'll see more of the future growth coming from these economies where we've been in a period where most of the growth has been coming from emerging markets, the BRIC countries, and many of these countries are seeing problems that they didn't have just 1, 2, 3 years ago, maybe except for India, both in Russia, in Brazil, in China. They are facing challenges which were not that high on their list of priorities just a few years ago. So it is a transition period which makes also this year's summit very, very interesting. I know you've had a lot of numbers already. I'll just give you 2 numbers. Thank you, by the way, for letting me be the last speaker before the coffee break that you started talking about more than 2 hours ago. But okay, 2 numbers. One of them is that the foreign direct investments in our region has actually recently fallen by 40%, or since 2000, 40% the investments coming into our region. And despite the outcome that we have been listening to this morning, and despite Germany, 90%, already next year, 90% of the growth that we see in the world would be generated outside Europe. From a business perspective, from our perspective, this is worrying, because it does show that we have a competitiveness challenge. No matter where we are on the rankings, it shows that investors do not foresee that the competitiveness of our region today or in the future, maybe especially in the future, that we will not be able to have the same high ranking when it comes to our competitiveness of European businesses. So this is, from our point, absolutely a must that emphasis is put on increasing, strengthening the competitiveness of European businesses, because no matter how you put it, it is the, if not the only, it is by far the best way to boost both growth and thereby also employment in Europe. In the Confederation of Danish Industry, we also annually make a global benchmark report, which comes out with many of the same conclusions that we've been listening to this morning. It's also analysis of the country's ability to develop an attractive business environment. And we also come out with the conclusions that our region tends to be very much ranked in the upper part of these indexes. Especially, I think one thing is very, very important for our economies. Many of them are small economies, but also the bigger ones in our region, that they are heavily involved and they are heavily dependent on global trade. So it's open economies, which are also in the mindset of our citizens, open in the way that we know that global trade and commercial relations between us and other countries are extremely important for us to continue the path that we want to go on. But again, our region should and cannot rest on our laurels. An enhanced regional cooperation could also actually be one of the levers for a continuous enhanced growth. We have a strong record for regional cooperation, and looking forward, we could join forces in selected areas which would allow the Baltic potential to be even larger. One thing we could do is that we could show the way forward also in the European cooperation for state-of-the-art implementation of the single market. This is something that really can benefit both consumers and also businesses. Now, the single market, as we've seen it, and at the way it has developed, of course, has led to both productivity gains in our countries and also to competitiveness gains among European companies. But it's definitely not complete. There's still a lot of things that can be done. Many sectors are struggling with the different national rules and legislation. And all these rules basically reduce the quality of the business environment. It hinders the free movement of goods, people, and services, and makes the EU a less attractive target for investments. Now, as I mentioned, the Baltic region could become a strong European voice for the full implementation of the internal market. We are on our way. We have, as also mentioned this morning, in our region made huge investments when it comes to infrastructure in the region already, constructing cross-border links such as the Öresund Bridge and the upcoming Fehmarn fixed link is also a very good example. In order for the true internal market to flourish, the improved infrastructure should be followed by a simplification of the administrative procedures linked to cross-border employment so that people can also work easily across borders. And this, of course, is a question of legislation, rules. It's also a question of a mindset, having a mindset, at least that's the big discussion in my country. We need a better mindset in order to actually to treasure the fact that people want to come to Denmark and provide their work and thereby also assisting us in developing our country and our economy. But that's another issue. Anyway, the free movement of people is key to enhanced growth. The ability for business to attract talented employees, young employees, talented employees is very, very important for fostering competitiveness in the society and competitive companies. Denmark is also among some of the countries that are facing an aging population, as was mentioned, and thereby also a smaller workforce. So what today is a discussion among people of lack of jobs, we are quite sure that very, very quickly, very, very soon, that will be a discussion that will be turned into actually lack of labor, at least in Denmark. Foreign employees currently make up 5% of the total workforce, and a lot of those 5% is actually coming from our neighboring countries in this region, in the Baltic region. So we should enhance inter-regional cooperation, which draws on the dynamics of our region. We should facilitate an open exchange of competences and encourage cross-border investments within our region. There's a true potential in the internal market. In the EU, it's estimated to be 50 billion euros. So we encourage the governments and the parliaments in our region to join forces and cooperate on securing that free movement of all level in the national administrations. So just to sum up, our focus today is regional, of course, but our common goal is to support the fragile economic growth in the entire Europe. Without competitive companies, there will be no economic growth. And without economic growth, there will be no new jobs. Only a competitive Europe can bring us back to the track of enhanced growth and job creation, and that the Baltic region can lead the way through a complete internal market and increased cross-border collaboration. So a lot of talk about growth, and I agree very much with, I think it was Helge that mentioned it, that why is growth necessary? That is an ongoing discussion also in Denmark. And people would often say, no, I don't need an extra TV. But it's a misunderstanding. Growth is really not about how many TVs you got in your home. That is a personal, individual decision that you take. Growth should be seen in another way. 15 years ago, Denmark was among the top five richest countries in the world. Today, only 15 years later, we are struggling. I think we are still among the top 15, but we are struggling to be in the top 15. If our growth will continue the way it has been doing for those 15 years, for just 10 or 15 years more, we will struggle to be among the top 25 countries in the world. And if you ask citizens, is that a problem? They would tend again to say, well, not necessarily. It's not a problem for me. But if you ask them whether it's okay that today 15 countries have better possibilities of providing per capita, better possibilities of providing welfare system, infrastructure, elder care, good schools, healthcare, and that in only 10 to 15 years later, it will be probably 25 countries which are able to provide that better than we are in a country like Denmark, then they would say, no, 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 no. That's not acceptable. Politicians must do something. And this is actually why responsible politicians in our region is trying to make the structural changes that we need in order to provide that growth in the future. It's a very difficult message to sell to many citizens, but it's an absolutely crucial policy to strive for. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thomas, thank you very much for giving us one of the main takeaways from this session, namely that we have a competitiveness challenge, as you said, regardless of where we are in the competitiveness ranking. Well, in our competitive position vis-a-vis the coffee break, we're not doing too well. We have run out of time, but I would like to take one or two questions to our speakers. We will continue this conversation in the second plenary. So if someone has a burning question or an observation, yes, you need to find your way to the microphone, or the microphone needs to find the way to you. It's microphone number 2, and if you could introduce yourself and be short
Thank
and
you.
Snappy.
Good morning. My name is Agla Obzorskaya, the Council of the Baltic Sea States Secretariat, and my comment and question is quite general. First of all, thank you very much. It's very inspiring and insightful. It gave a lot of food for thought. What I take firstly out of this morning session is that we're talking about change, which is needed for this growth to happen, whether it's structural change, whether investments, labor, change in labor growth, and so on. But what I lack hearing of is how whether we should not also think about the ways the various stakeholders and the various roles in our of actors in our societal organizations should be perhaps also rethought and reshifted. And what I'm talking about is perhaps what the panel could, because we used to have various traditional roles of how various sectors are responsible for certain tasks in the society. It's a labor division. And perhaps what it would be interesting from you to hear, how do you see that, for instance, this kind of labor division can be and responsibilities can be rethought? And for instance, how more can we speak about, when we speak about competitiveness, how more the private sector could think about social, more social-oriented entrepreneurship, social businesses, and how do you see that perhaps the public sector could think more about take more entrepreneurial mindset.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Brilliant question. And the second one.
I'm not sure if it's working. Eva Rominska Zimny from the Warsaw School of Economics, Poland. It was very interesting. I think we all agreed that growth is needed, and we are trying to look for new sources of growth. And my question is, could you comment on a so-called female factor? which is very often mentioned as a new source of growth because of the role of women on the labor market as a new possibility to increase labor force, which it will be missing, as we've heard already, but also the value of diversity and talents which women have, which will bring a new angle to this competitiveness of development of services and other new branches. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Two excellent questions, and I need two volunteers now from among the panelists. We won't have time for comments from everyone. I see, Christian, that you would like to respond to one of the questions. First one, second one?
Yeah, I can please take the first one.
Okay.
So I think there are two aspects to this. I completely agree we need to find new ways of engaging with each other. I think the old models and the old institutions are probably not enough to raise our competitiveness. You know, how do we engage the smaller companies, the startups, in a better way? How do we engage science in a better way? We've been talking about triple helix, about clusters. We still need to find the right type of models to move things forward, and I hope that this type of forum here can create the right kind of environment. The second issue that you mentioned is the social entrepreneurship, and I think this is a huge field where we could be a world leader. I think we have entrepreneurial capacity here. We think very highly of our aspirations, at least, to create high social standards. We will need to mobilize entrepreneurship to address these issues. I think we need to experiment much more in this area. But there will be no easy solutions. You know, I think this is not a magic silver bullet, but an area, and I think, which we can excel if we put our heart to it.
And Helge, if you could have your stint at the second question.
Yes, I will try to address the second question. And I do believe in female power, no doubt about that. But I think when we look at our region, it doesn't really hold for the Nordic countries where the participation ratio is as high for women in the labor market as for men right now. It's close to 80%. More in countries like Poland, Germany, some of the Baltics, I would say you could see a kind of a religious difference, because from the more Catholic countries you have seen a lower participation ratio for women in the labor market. So I do believe in that. That is a reserve which can be drawn into the labor force and can help boosting growth in the years to come. Still, we cannot help the demographic situation. I think actually in the longer run, we have to accept that the potential growth rate will be somewhere between 1 and 1.5% in Europe, unless something really changes. And of course, we could maybe help the demographic situation by getting more babies. I mean, it's so fun to make them, it's so hard to raise them. I don't know if there is an easy answer to that question. But on the other hand, in case that we do need to raise more babies, then it will be another challenge, of course, also to make all the institutions ready in the countries to increase the female participation ratio. But to be frank, I have a relatively gloomy outlook on the growth future for Europe as such because of demographics. It's a huge challenge. We need all the digital revolution. We need all what we can to enforce investments to boost productivity. And then we need also maybe to be able to attract the well-educated and skilled immigrants from abroad. I mean, there Europe is having a huge challenge. The US is able to do so. They can attract the most talented youngsters from the whole world. Europe is having a challenge there, and there we need probably also to have a brand new policy.
Thank you so much to all of the speakers. This session has been a definite food for thought session. It's stuffed up. So we've been introduced with this whole idea of a new normal where slower, lower growth in the range of 1.5 to 2% we're looking at. Falling investments, a little bit of the dark cloud on the future rolling in, we heard from Thomas. But we also heard of some areas where we can focus on to improve the situation, both on the productivity side and the labor mobilization side, with smarter investments in smart infrastructure, including energy, efficient infrastructure, digitization, different employment models, more dynamic employment, where youth employment and attracting labor in a better way. and mobilizing engagement, drawing on complementary competencies around the region. Again, these macro-regional value chains. So we've had some themes brought up in this session that we will continue to discuss over the coming days. Thank you very much to all of our speakers and panelists. And before I let you go to the coffee break, the strong Finnish coffee, which we all voted for, want to remind you to pick up an interpretation, one of these headsets for interpretation. You will need this in the second plenary session. Thank you very much, and be back here at 12:45.